Okay, dito tayo sa second portion po natin ay tungkol dito sa rule of law natin and aking pakiramdam at pakiramdam ni Senator Tatad sa kanyang column recently na namamatay na kung di pa patay ang rule of law. Nakita po natin dyan sa treatment ng Korte Suprema doon sa kaso ni the American citizen Grace Po that they are railroading to become a Filipino natural-born citizen. Ano? So this is a major blow that even the Integrated Bar Association of the Philippines as well as the Philippine Bar Association have openly spoken considered this an anomalous situation. I think for the IBP, this is the only the second time they have spoken up. No, they have spoken and we are aghast that the Supreme Court under Sereno can do this. Although we have to give credit to the other members of the Supreme Court that are standing up, to this wayward handling of the Sereno leadership in the Supreme Court. So this has many implications. And are we seeing the death of the rule of law in this case? So we'll be discussing this among other issues, and maybe later on, because our senatorial aspirant, General Dado Valeroso, is with us, maybe we can touch on the rule of law and the difficulties with implementing it in the case of the Kidapawan incident. Pero it is Ferdy who has some very specific ideas on this death of the rule of law in this country. Well, make your case.
First of all, as citizens, we are not required to become lawyers all. But all of us are required to study the Constitution and see for ourselves and read for ourselves the Constitution and relevant laws. For example, I would like to, if can be shown on the camera. This is a Section 3 of Republic Act 9225, which is the dual citizenship law. And as you can see, and I will quote from Section 3, any provision of law to the contrary notwithstanding, natural-born citizens by reason of their naturalization as citizens of a foreign country, for example, if you become a U.S. Citizen, are hereby deemed to have reacquired Philippine citizenship upon taking the oath of allegiance to the Republic. Now, this law does not say that you will be able to reacquire natural-born status. It only says that you will be able to reacquire Philippine citizenship.
Which could be naturalized or natural-born?
No.
No longer natural-born.
I will show you why you cannot reclaim your natural-born status. Let's quote from the Constitution, Article 4. If this can be shown in the...
Okay, let's try it again. Okay.
Citizenship.
Sige.
Okay. Article 4 of the Constitution. Yeah, this is Section 2. Okay. So it says here, natural-born citizens are those who are citizens of the Philippines from birth. Now, the Supreme Court amended this to at birth. But because the Supreme Court...
Of course, the Supreme Court cannot amend the law,
yes,
or the Constitution.
Especially the Constitution. Mm. So it is very clear, from birth, without having to perform any act to
so
acquire
malinaw,
or perfect their citizenship.
So, if in between you did an act to lose it and then reacquire it, you're no longer natural born.
Yeah.
That's very clear
it
from
It says
that.
Here, if you perform any act to acquire or perfect Philippine citizenship, you are no longer natural born. So if you abjure your Philippine citizenship in favor of American citizenship, you lose not only your citizenship, but your
natural born
status. Now in going back to becoming Filipino again, you have to perform an act. What is that act? The taking of oath of allegiance to the Republic of the Philippines and also the application under the dual citizenship law. Now the Constitution says that if you perform an act, you are no longer a natural-born citizen. Supreme Court, again, amended this by saying that if the act is naturalization, then you are are not able to regain your natural born status, but if the act is repatriation, then you are able to regain your natural born status. But the Constitution does not distinguish between naturalization and repatriation. The Constitution clearly states that any act, if you perform any act to acquire or perfect your Philippine citizenship, you are no longer natural born. And another thing is that dual citizens, allegiance of citizens is inimical to the national interest. This is Section 3 and Section 5 of the 1987 Philippine Constitution.
Sa baba, yeah, lower. Yan. Yung importante, Section 5.
Yan, okay. So, Section 3, Philippine citizenship may be lost or reacquired in the manner provided by law. It does not say that Philippine natural born status may be lost or reacquired in the manner provided by law. It is very, very clear, it's only citizenship. Now, dual allegiance of citizens is inimical to the national interest. Now, why did the Americans invented the idea of natural born status? And why do they not allow a former foreign citizen to become president of the United States? Because of allegiance. Allegiance is directly related to natural born status. That's why the Americans, when they invented the natural born status concept, they want somebody who has never acquired any foreign citizenship to become their president. But all throughout his or her life, he has always been an American citizen.
And natural born for them is born of parents born in the U.S. In the dahil usoli sila.
Now, the question is, when somebody abjures or turns his or her back on the Philippines by taking the oath of allegiance, for example, to the United States, they are required to have an oath. And the oath says that I hereby declare on oath that I absolutely and entirely renounce and abjure all allegiance to any state or sovereignty, that is the Philippines. So if you renounce and abjure your Philippine citizenship and your allegiance to the Republic of the Philippines, then you lose your natural born status because you have already turned your back on your country. Now, in coming back to becoming a Filipino again, you should not be allowed to become president anymore.
Well, that was a point Binay tried to raise in one of the debates, di ba? Pero hindi naintindihan ng publiko yung abjure. Ano? And so, you see, ito ay yung pag-aaral ng batas natin, kahit na every citizen should know, most of them really do not have, you know, do not devote any time to it. Nakinig ako sa radio isang beses, isang entertainment anchor, sinasabi, nag-desisyon na yung Korte Suprema, tanggapin na natin, tumahimik na lang kayo. Ano? Unfortunately, mal-edukado din yung radio anchor. Paano yan? Di ba?
Yeah, the last point, Kamentong, the last point is this part of the oath of allegiance to the United States. If we can show it in the camera, the upper part.
I will bear arms.
I will bear arms on behalf of the United States when required by law. What if the United States enters into a war with the Philippines? So when you are required by the United States law, you will bear arms against the Filipinos? So should we still allow somebody like this to become president of the country?
Well, apparently, mga 20%, 25%, if you believe some surveys, 30% of the people still believe that whatever that says, it doesn't matter because they like this personality.
But it's such a dangerous precedent. And the Supreme Court is supposed to be the protector of the Constitution. Now, this is not subject to popularity.
In other words, what you're saying, pwede sa ang ordinaryong mamamayan magkamali dyan, pero ang Korte Suprema, hindi dapat magkamali dyan o magmamangmangmangan. Pero actually, ginagawa ni Sereno yan at yung pitong kanyang little mental dwarfs. So, Sereno and the seven dwarfs. Yeah, sige, Dato, as a implementer of the law, hindi ka ba namang problema dito?
Hindi naman ako nababahala sa tingin ko dahil kung sinasabi natin, rest in peace na yung rule of law, medyo malayo pa tayo dyan. Kasi kung ang pinag-uusapan naman natin dito ay tungkol sa Constitution, ito yung test para sa ating lahat. Are we really a mature democracy now? No? In terms of toleration ng mga iba't ibang views, kagaya ng view na rin ng Supreme Court, kung ang hinihintay nila, hindi sila makapag-desisyon ng tama para dun sa status ni Ginang Po at gusto pa nilang idaan yan sa election at para madesisyonan na ng taong bayan, parang hugas kamay yun eh. Bayaan natin ang taong bayan magdesisyon. Pag nanalo, di tsaka natin sagutin ulit yung issue about the natural born status. Otherwise, pag natalo, wala na tayo. Fight accompli na yun eh. So that's the test. And probably one of the very rare condition that this May 9, 2016 elections offer us as a people. Kailangan yung social tolerance natin na te-test dito. Yung rule of law naman, very simple. Kung nakikita ng ibang kababayan natin, yung Supreme Court ay medyo sumusuway na rin. Kailangan siguro hikayatin natin sila. Let's encourage them to review our constitution and look for the fine prints. Minsan nga, kailangan mo lang literal interpretation nung nandun na sa constitution eh, at igagalang nila yon. Kung sa ganun, dapat as early as now or even way, way before na onset nitong controversy na to, kailangan nag-desisyon na po sila. Kaya nga po sila nandyan. Kaya nga sa isa sa mga naiisip kong legislative programs natin, isa doon na yung justice system reform, no? Or reform in the justice system. Kailangan yung judicial body natin, meron siyang autonomy, no? Or independence dun sa appointing power. Biro mo, may tatlo tayong malalaking bahay. Merong executive, legislative, judiciary. Eh, yung executive mo yun na nag...
May tatlong malalaking bahay, pero may isang higanteng mansyon ng financial oligarchs.
Yeah, isa pa yan.
Lahat ng tatlong maliliit na bahay na yan ay mga bahay ng mga alipin sa gigilid. Dambuhalang mansyon na kanina pinag-usapan natin, because of the financial system, ang nagahari ay mga korporasyon eh. Yan ang problema eh. So, anumang ganda ng legislative agenda ng anumang kandidato, totoo pagdating yan sa katotohanan ng poder, the financial power before the power of the gun precedes all our good intentions eh. Ngayon kung magising ang taong bayan at sabi mukhang may problema tayo dahil kahit ano sabihin natin hindi mangyayari and so you had revolutions, the French Revolution, the Chinese Revolution, aabot na doon sa paggamit ng gulok kung sa makalumang lipunan natin or sa armas, and so this is a dilemma. The Supreme Court is abetting future violence because of its unwillingness to implement the law, because of its bludgeoning, pagpatay nito sa gulok ng kanilang maling interpretasyon ng batas. Yan ang problema eh.
Yung leakages kamentong eh.
Ay, yung mga leakage nga eh.
Labas sa batas yung leakage.
Bakit April 6, nag-anunsyo na itong si Sereno na doon sa Baguio, nagdesisyon na final na pwedeng tumakbo si Po. Tapos sasabihin ng spokesman niya, April 9 pa ang formal na anunsyo. Anong klaseng korte? Bakit nila minamadali? Ang sabi nga ng iba kasi meron ng second tranche. Merong second tranche. I'm not saying we can only speculate. Correct. But what is the motive for trying to advance it by 4 days?
At saka bakit nalalaman kaagad ng mga certain newspapers yung magiging desisyon? Ibig sabihin, merong nagli-leak galing sa loob eh. Tapos parang ang nangyayari na tuloy, eto na ang desisyon ng Supreme Court, edi na-condition na yung utak ng mga tao na pag naiba dito yung desisyon, magagalit
yun
yung tao.
Yun ang isang motivasyon.
At napuwersa yung mga Supreme Court justices na sumunod na doon sa newspaper. Ang susundan na nila yung desisyon ng newspaper, hindi na yung desisyon according to the Constitution.
Itong mga nagdedesisyon na sobrang favorable dito kay Little Miss Popet ang tawag sa kanya, karamihan appointee ni Noynoy Aquino. So, yun ang mga problema natin when we talk about the rule of law. Yan ang mga problema dyan. And nag-review tayo ng Constitution courtesy of Cafferty dito. In the Constitution kasi, when all else fails, you have to interpret it literally. When all else fails. Sometimes, sasabihin nila, you have to go into the spirit of the law. Pero if the spirit is confused, deliberately or by accident hindi magkasundo doon sa spirit, you have to go back to the literal interpretation of the Constitution. Kasi walang ibang babasehan kundi yung salita na nakalagay dyan sa saligang batas. Eh.
Kamentong kasi minsan na nako-confuse sila because of the color of the money.
Ah, yun na nga ang problema
lalo
natin.
Lalo na kung colorblind na sila.
Kaya nga, my advocacy is that money should be controlled by the public. Ano? But that's another discussion. Kasi may kaugnayan doon sa unang segment sa, natin. Yeah. Kaya may mga bansang umuunlad, may mga bansang nagkakagulo. What do I mean? In China, banking is controlled by the state. The creation of credit and currency, printing of money, is controlled by the state. Therefore, ang interest ng public ang dapat manguna dyan. But when you are a debt-based financial system like the U.S., as Ferdy was explaining, ang U.S. government kasi cannot create money without borrowing from the U.S. Federal Reserve. The U.S. Federal Reserve is not a public bank. It is a private bank, which many people do not know. Ano? Sana we can have Hero some other day to explain this.
At yung kinorek ni Kennedy yung situation, inutusan niya yung Department of the Treasury na mag-print ng dollars, not long after, napatay si Kennedy.
So, it focuses us on the importance of understanding the financial system. Ano, and kanina, tinatanong mo, off the air, after the Hero went to the sidelines, no? At paano natin i-correct ito? One of the measures that the Garcia administration in the 1950s instituted was currency and capital controls as part of the Filipino First policy. Meaning, hindi mo i-free float ang pera mo na kung anong desisyon sa U.S. Federal Reserve, yun ang siyang gagabay naman sa balor ng piso. Kaya ang problema nga natin ngayon, mag-savings tayo, ngayon maganda, 47 to the dollar, bukas 45 to the dollar, anong gagawin ko? Eh, gastahin ko na lang na bago bumagsak pa ito and so on. No? And so these are the issues. And unfortunately, the public does not have the capacity to keep up with these changes. Globalization and so on. Itong AMLA, binibintang nila sa China, binibintang nila sa Pilipinas at mga Filipino bankers. Ang mga originators ng money laundering, Western na capitalist corporations and so on.
Nasaan ba yung $81 million bago nanakaw?
The U.S. Federal Reserve. At bakit kinailangan
New
ng New York Federal Reserve. Bakit kinailangan mag-deposit si ang Bangladesh doon? Kanina pinaliwanag ni Hero Baswani because of the dollarized global financial system. Kailangan i-convert mo sa dollar, i-deposit mo para yun for many reasons, including earning interest.
That's why we want future leaders like Senator Dado Valeroso to spearhead the movement to protect the sovereignty and independence of the country by regaining our economic independence.
Financial independence.
And also the rule of law.
Fundamental yan kasi nung pumasok si Cory Aquino, pumasok yung liberalization, including the financial system. So we lost control or substantial control kahit na during the time of Marcos, of course, he was struggling also with exchange rate dahil dollar-based din na tayo. We had to always adjust to what the dollar value is. And then in 72, nag-decouple lang dollar sa gold. And so lalong naging komplikado yan. So
let's hear from General Valeroso because he's the founder of the Young Officers Union, which espouses nationalism. So, ano po kaya, General? We now want to hear from you. Ano po ba ang magandang gawin natin dito? Not only to be, when you are already in the Senate.
Meron ng magandang ginawa siya eh. He has asked Hero Baswani to help him further elaborate on his on financial program.
Meron tayo dyan tinatawag na sa strategic development legislative agenda natin. Kasi iniisip natin, kahit na sino po yung maluklok na presidente at wala siyang kaalyado sa Senado, unang-una niyan, ang i-implement niya rin within the very same system na karamihan sa atin, disgustado na, no? At yung component naman niyang strategic development legislative agenda na yan ay economic sovereignty, social justice, at saka political security. Halos may apat na mga proposed bills doon. Ngayon pa lang, nagre-ready na tayo in case naman na palarin tayo at iluklok tayo ng ating mga kababayan bilang isa sa mga pangunahing senador ng bansa na to. So the president will really need a team inside the legislature. If someone who wins and he wants our direction to be a transformation from a central republican to a federal republic, maasahan niyo po na naka-ready na rin tayo dyan. Ang unang batas po na pinopropose natin doon ay Constitutional Convention Bill. Dahil hindi mo mapapalitan ang uri o klase ng ating gobyerno ngayon kung wala kang batas. Mm. Kailangan po tayo ron. The Constitutional Convention Bill is a way for us to elect the delegates to a constitutional convention. Mm. One of the three ways to amend or change our constitution.
Okay. Well, we're coming to the end of our second segment, you know, and so all this we can further discuss, but let's go to one of the burning issues of the day, no, yung nangyari sa Kidapawan, ano. Mm. There is a hunger among farmers. Mm. If that is true, why is there hunger? I think you have to go back to the policy of government that changed from Marcos' time to Cory's time, from one of national development to one of corporate development. Mm. Ano? Kasi yung mga irrigation programs were relegated to lower priorities. Mm. Corporate profits became the higher priority. Number two, agricultural self-sufficiency was relegated to lower priorities, and so on. So these are policy questions. Number two, being a police general, what happened there? Kung sasabihin ang NPA ay may kamay sa likod, agitation, mm-hmm, and so on, mm-hmm, that is a trap that is already well known, di ba?
Laging ginagamit yun.
Everybody uses it. Even the leftists would use it. The rightists in Ukraine used it, uh-huh, sa Maidan. Ano? It's an old tactic.
Old cliche.
So give us your...
Una, tingnan natin sa mas malalim na perspektiba, no? Yung policy. May pagkukulang ang gobyerno. Aminin natin yan. Isa tayong archipelago. Napapalibutan tayo ng tubig. Doon pa lang sa usapin ng public infrastructure, mainly on embankment of water and the water distribution, specifically irrigation. Alam naman natin, agricultural economy tayo. So, kailangan natin ng patubig. Mm. How come dito na lang yata sa Pilipinas, sa parte ng Asia, kung hindi man sa buong mundo, na ang pamahalaan natin ay naniningil ng irrigation fee sa mga magsasaka.
Very fundamental.
Tanggalin na natin yan. Mm. So, kung hindi man natin matanggal yan through an executive order, di isabatas na rin natin. Mm. Kailangan lang siguro natin i-criss-cross itong archipelago
natin
ng supply
of water.
We have 1 minute
left.
No?
In fact, yung privatization of water is part of the problem. But that's another policy
issue,
question you
course,
can raise.
Specifically in Metro Manila, the concessionaires. Huwag muna nating dalhin yung usapin doon. But we have to have an agriculture productivity through the self-sufficiency ng programs natin. Mm. No? Irrigation, technical assistance, yung mga binhi natin, high-yielding variety, post-harvest facilities. Mm. Hindi tayo magkakaroon ng kinabawan,
kagutuman.
No? Lalong-lalo na kung ang mga magsasaka natin ay magiging sufficient.
Finally, yung police equipment, capability, officers development, how is it now?
Dun sa Kitawawan incident, makikita natin na hindi naman, unang-una, hindi kailangan na mag-deploy ng mga police doon, ng mga sundalo, uniformed personnel. Bayaan mo sila ron, yung redress of grievance, nanghihingi sila ng food subsidies, nanghihingi sila ng food aid.
Mm. No? So may failure yung civilian government.
Yung use of
government.
Force spectrum natin, kung mapapansin niyo, that's senseless and brutal.
Okay.
Hindi naangkop sa ganong klaseng sitwasyon.
Unfortunately, we've run out of time. Maybe anything? 5 seconds?
Well, General Dado Valeroso, I'm not saying you vote for him, but I will vote for him.
Okay. Sige. Maraming salamat po. And so, until next week po, we thank Hero Vaswani and our other guests here. Tune in again next week po. Have a good weekend.
Salamat.